You're listening to Destination Utopia. I am Bunny Williams, and with me is...
Rose Mead.
Yeah, I wanted to make sure that we didn't do too much pre-talk so that we get into a conversation and I forget to hit the record like I did on the last show, which is the best show ever.
It was even better
than the Pope on Films Guardians of the Galaxy episode. That was the podcast
that was the
best podcast out of all the podcasts, which I recorded it.
We can try again. You know, it's a good sign. Well, it means we're getting more into the step of things.
This one is definitely recording now. So, let's see here. Did you want to just start off with what you have?
Yes, I wanted to start kind of talking about the recent events in France, the Charlie Hebdo shooting, kind of talking about the way France is dealing with it, kind of the hypocrisy in the situation. And I want to find out what you knew about it.
I am aware of the situation. I do not know exactly what happened there. I know it is a satirical magazine of some sort, which for some reason in my head says Mad Magazine, like that kind of a thing, because Mad Magazine used to be really kind of biting in its day. And they were shot by Muslim extremists. Now, I'm a little confused about what the particular thing was. I know there's a picture of Muhammad floating around who's crying.
That one was after the shooting?
What's that?
That one was produced after the shooting and published in their very next issue. The one that really got people outraged and got them over there shooting them, they had a picture of Muhammad, which is apparently against Islamic rules. Like, you can't have a picture or, like, any kind of form symboling Muhammad. So they went ahead and did that, and it was actually a pretty offensive picture. It was basically gay sex, Muhammad having gay sex. So it was meant to be inflammatory. So not only were they depicting their prophet, he was in a very, what they would consider a very sinful situation.
Yeah. But still, you're not gonna get sense out of extremists, you know, but to kill somebody for a form of speech because you don't like what they said.
Because you were offended and it hurt your feelings. And basically what it boils down to, they're clinging to religion. And this is why I think about religion, is people cling to it because if they think for a second that they're wrong, then they don't know what's going to happen to them after they die. They have to face their mortality, like, head on. And that's why people cling to religion so much and get so upset when it's questioned.
Yeah. So, it's like, the best I can say about the situation is that they're wrong, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I can't really expound on that any further.
You can't murder people for being rude.
Yeah. But at the same time, you can't stop people from murdering people because they're rude.
Mm-hmm.
They're already kind of like unhinged, you know?
Right.
So,
you know, murder is already illegal. So really, there's not much more they can do. Freedom of speech is a right that needs to be protected. And in France, they already had laws in place. There's actually really specific laws like against freedom of speech. The one is law against Holocaust denial.
Yeah, I mean,
and obviously the Holocaust
happened,
but you can't prevent people from denying it. They can be stupid, and everybody can know that they're stupid. I have a hard time understanding the logic behind imprisoning them for denying that it happened.
The logic behind imprisoning people who do not believe the Holocaust happened?
Uh-huh.
I'm kind of glad you raised that point, because I have a similar point that's been really bugging me, and it came up like for a half a second on one of the other shows when we were talking about protesters in hoodies, and you had mentioned that it was like an expansion of the Ku Klux Klan hood law.
Oh, uh-huh.
I find that law stupid. In very
right,
much the same way,
to...
locking up Holocaust. You know what? You make it illegal to wear their hoods. You haven't gotten rid of racists. You just made them harder to identify.
Right. You're trying to ban the symbology that they use, but they'll still communicate.
Yeah. So it's like, you know, you see a guy come up in a full Ku Klux Klan outfit. You look at him and you're like, okay. I know what I'm dealing with. I know exactly what I'm dealing with, okay? Now you got to talk to somebody for a good 10, 15 minutes to get to that same point.
I mean,
the point of
the hood, though, was to hide their identity. So you didn't know who was under the hood. Yeah, originally.
Mm-hmm. And interesting fact. Are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Okay. An interesting fact, do you know the Ku Klux Klan started as a small literary club?
I did not know that. That's crazy. I have to look that one up.
You know, so the same kind of literary club that, you know, J.R.R. Tolkien and C.S. Lewis were in.
Mm-hmm.
It was just a thing people did back then. You know, it would be a little kind of social thing. You'd all agree on a particular book to read, you know, and you'd get together like once a month and talk about it.
Uh-huh. Wow. How did it kind of de-evolve into this racist, slashing, burning, murdering gang?
I don't know, but isn't that an interesting question?
Yeah, it's like, can we look at all the activities you do daily in the clubs that you're a part of? You have to wonder, like, what is this going to lead to?
Yeah. That's almost like if the Girl Scouts all suddenly became snipers. You know, like how did we get from here to there?
Somebody didn't like their cookies.
What is the connective tissue? So
I wonder what books they read.
What?
I wonder what books they read.
Probably the same ones that just about everybody else read, because it wasn't like there were a whole lot of books.
Well, what year was this?
We're
what era?
Like mid-18, you know, like 1850.
Okay. Books are a little bit hard to get a hold of, so yeah. Crazy, though.
You know, and you'd have to order, and they'd take forever to show up, and all that kind of stuff. Not like a magazine that comes out once a month or however often Charlie Hebdo came out.
Mm-hmm.
And I imagine it's a bigger thing in France. I mean, has anybody here heard of them before this?
Not until this incident. I don't think so. Nobody I know of. Like, it wasn't in mainstream knowledge.
Yeah. But it So I can only imagine that it is very popular in France for it to be getting this kind of press. But it kind of puts them in the same, well, you know, we can argue about whether it puts it in the same kind of category, but the same kind of category of Martin Luther King getting shot for everything he wants to say, or Bobby Kennedy getting shot. You know, the same kind of thing. I mean,
well, this is even more superficial with Charlie Hebdo, because they weren't, I don't think they're really kind of social leaders. They weren't leading a movement or anything. They're just using their offices drawing cartoons, kind of satirical commentary.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So it's just wrong.
They
decided to take them out.
It happened to have offended the wrong people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that shouldn't mean that you shouldn't keep speaking out.
No, definitely not. You should speak out more.
Yeah.
I'm kind of surprised at how many kind of world leaders are kind of taking, kind of gradually moving to the side, like taking sides with the attackers. Like everyone's kind of saying, you know, well, you shouldn't poke fun at people's religions. The Pope said that. I'm pretty sure
that's the first,
that effect.
That's
I
like
couldn't
the first
find
time
it.
This Pope disappointed me.
Right, yeah.
Other than that, he's been pretty cool. It's like, yeah, no, sorry, Francis. You know,
and the French laws that I looked up a little bit, kind of supporting the, they're not supporting free speech as much as they should be. They're kind of, they're really eradicating it.
Yeah.
Obviously, like, the murder of people is still illegal, but they're kind of being apologists about it. Like, well, you know.
And
at the same time, they have a law against terrorist apologists. So if you're, you're kind of doing the same thing as they're kind of doing right now, saying, well, you know, if they did that, you know, had a reason, kind of apologize and form and stuff. Apparently, there's a law against that and a law against glorification of crimes. So if, and there has been, there was some sort of comedian in France that was actually arrested. He had previous things that he had said that had gotten him in trouble. And he said something, you know, in support of these guys. Like, all of these laws that they have are, like, attacking freedom of speech, but at the same time, protecting people that attack people for speaking out.
Yeah. Yeah. You know what it really equates to more than, like Martin Luther King or anything like that, it's really a lot closer to Larry Flint, I would think. The publisher
right,
of
so I don't know who that is. You have to fill me in.
The publisher of Hustler Magazine?
Hustler Magazine. I don't think I ever read that.
I'm pretty sure you haven't.
I know.
It's a popular porn mag.
Mm-hmm. I know that.
But it was also very, I don't know if liberal is the right word, or it was just like Larry Flint really liked pissing people off, you know? So if he could take jabs at the government, he would. You know, I don't know if that necessarily makes you a liberal. You know what I mean?
No, I don't think so. I think whenever there is a Democrat in office, or, you know, it switches over back and forth, like the criticizing the government switches back and forth between political parties.
Yeah. He had one, he had a page, so I used to read it from time to time.
From time to time.
For the articles.
You used to.
It had a full color sheet. It had a lot of jokes in the magazine, too. And one was a full-page color photo of Jesus in a dress on the cross, and it was captioned Drag Queen of the Jews.
Oh, man, but that pissed so many people off. My
so
Christian guys
was,
are like, oh, my God, I'm like, we shouldn't be reading that anyway.
Yeah. And then he got into a Titanic fight with Jerry Falwell, and there were a lot of court cases about the things that he was saying in his magazine, and he was shot. He wasn't killed.
Wow.
He was shot. There's the movie The People versus Larry Flint. I forget who directed it. It might be Oliver Stone, but I'm not sure. And it has Woody Harrelson in it as Larry Flint. Check that out. That'll give you a good idea.
All right, I might look it up.
But I think that might be the closest thing that this equates to.
Yeah, it's kind of, there's a level of ridiculous in it. People are taking things personal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, people are taking things way too personal. What's all this junk over this American Sniper movie?
I know, I haven't seen it. I read a little bit about it. I don't plan on seeing it. I definitely feel like it's propaganda.
It's a movie, you know. It's all propaganda one way or another.
That's very true. Especially sci-fi.
It's all a kind. kind of manipulation.
Everybody has their agenda, and that's true. This particular agenda, I just don't even want to deal with it. I don't want to be exposed to it. Like, I don't want it to piss me off. I don't want to sit down on the couch all angry.
Yeah. I mean, I haven't even seen a preview for it, but just the title American Sniper, it's not particularly my kind of movie.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but it's a fucking movie. You know?
Right, I guess it's just a movie.
Michael Moore or Seth Rogen says.
I know, everybody's kind of like missing the whole point entirely. Like, well, they said that, so I'm going to be pissed off about what this other guy said. It has nothing to do with anything. It's irrelevant. Like, Michael Moore didn't even say what they said he said.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they said that he called that guy a coward. But what he said is his uncle and his dad were in one war or another, and one of them got killed by a sniper, and the other one to talk about how it's such a cowardly way to fight a war. So just kind of like commentary on his personal like family experiences.
Yeah. And
but he was kind of like talking about the other side of it that people that love this movie don't even want to consider.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I know some of it in the movie is, you know, it's war and it's terrible and everybody's killing everybody because that's what it is. You know, what happens, they kind of dehumanize the other side. They make it, you know, easier, make it okay to kill them, torture them. And that's all ongoing. It's happening every day.
Mm-hmm.
That's kind of the part that people don't want to talk about, is how they really dehumanize the opponents in the movie.
Dehumanize who?
The opponents, like the Arabs, the Muslims, the people that they're killing, and then are killing them. Now, both sides are doing the same exact thing.
Mm-hmm. It's a war, and soldiers follow orders.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's a movie. You know, I don't see why it's so hotly debated. Or seems to be, because I actually haven't read any of it, but just keep popping up on the
screen. Yeah, there's certain people that are really into defending it, and certain people that are really into attacking it.
Yeah.
You say, like, you know, the ultra-conservative, kind of stereotypical America. Then, like, you know, the ultra-liberals kind of against all war and everything, and they want the world to be a happy place. And I think that is, you know, it could happen tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
And kind of one-sided, you know, both sides, like, really one-sided. Like, one side is, you know, all about America and our soldiers and blah, blah, blah. The other side is, you know, totally about, you know, protecting other people from ourselves, basically, is kind of what I'm getting out of it.
Mm-hmm.
Both sides are ignoring, like, the other part of the problem.
At the same time, though, I almost kind of wonder if it's not set up.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because it would not be the first time that a fake controversy was created to sell a movie.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Kind of like The Interview, maybe.
You like The Interview? That was kind of fun. But I also remembered, like, a few months earlier, like maybe 6 or 8 months earlier, Kim Jong, whatever, I forget this new dude's name. I'm still stuck on the old
Kim
guy.
Kim Jong-un?
Oh, yeah.
Father.
It kind of sounds like a stomach upset, doesn't it? Kim Jong.
Well, I don't know.
He came out with a statement that if this movie was released, he was going to nuke America.
Uh-huh.
He was going to start a nuclear war. And then we come up to the release time, and there's this whole happened bit.
Yeah, it's silly. It's another person taking things, you know, like, way seriously, way personal. I mean, it was a movie, like, about killing him. I get that. But at the same time, like, he's starting to nuke everybody, like, all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's something wrong with that family.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
They're just incredibly entitled. Like, it's impossible to know, like, what goes on. They're just, like, so entitled, and they think that they are the shit.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then North Korea got shut down for like 3 or 4 days.
Mm-hmm. The internet got turned off.
Yeah.
I'm not sure like who there is even using the internet anyway. It's just the government pretty much.
Yeah.
That's just sad. I think it's a really sad situation. And people, they've read a few things. I think, like, watch a documentary. How people have gone in there to visit, and, like, everything they see is staged. Like, that's really how it is. The people they meet, like, they've been, like, talked to by the government and told, like, what to say and how to act and everything.
Yeah.
And so, like, you meet these people, like, it's, like, staged, like I said, and it's just so awkward. And there's questions, like, the journalists want to ask. They know they can't ask them.
Mm-hmm.
They want to ask, like, do you really live in this house? And stuff like that. So they have, you know, a list of questions they're allowed to ask.
Yeah.
And it's really kind of sad. People, they don't know any different. And then they kind of buy into everything the government told them, all the propaganda, because that's just, they don't have any other ideas or way of living to look at.
Yeah. Well, there is a bit of an underground going on where there are quite a few of them that are sneaking down to North Korea.
Mm-hmm.
And then
South
they're
Korea.
Doing like a... What?
They're sneaking down to South Korea.
To South Korea, yeah. And they're once they're there, then, you know, they get jobs, they settle in, they start buying video equipment and things like that. And videotaping things,
mm-hmm.
not really. They're, you know, they're digital formats, and sneaking them back over the border on flash drives.
That's good. That's really awesome.
To try to let the rest of the North Koreans know what things are like outside.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
that's really awesome.
Like
they're doing that, and they're doing it, you know, for their people, their family, and their friends. They're risking their lives to do that, literally.
Mm-hmm. A few of them have internet shows and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what you would search under for them. There's a documentary on Netflix. There are a couple of them on Netflix right now, and I forget which one I watched, but there are a couple of documentaries on North Korea.
So, talk about freedom of speech and the lack of it.
But oddly enough, I was watching it, and there were a couple of people that the police were given problems to about different things, and they would fight back, and they would argue and things like that, and you know what? They didn't get shot.
That's amazing.
So I don't know, North Korea kind of has one up on us there. And they would be
that's
going off on these
thing.
Cops. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
I mean, it would all be in North
Korea.
Right,
I wouldn't have expected that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's too
good. You know, from there,
the
police are just trying to calm shit down again.
Yeah, I wonder, do the cops have guns?
I am not sure.
Because they might. Really, even with their cops, limit the amount of power that they have.
Yeah.
Can they give the whole police force guns and a police revolt or something? Because I feel like North Korea is really super paranoid about that happening.
Yeah.
For good reason.
Whereas I didn't see it. I've heard a couple of things, and I kind of like it. We had the State of the Union address.
Oh, yeah, something about that, because I did not watch it or listen to it.
I heard of some of it, and it sounds like my boy, Obama. we're really tight
man
now.
Man crush.
Yeah, we're really tight now. This might be my first man crush, actually. Really gave such a beautiful fuck you to the whole GOP. Oh, how wonderful. He had said something like, I'm not campaigning. I campaigned. I won. I campaigned. Mm-hmm. I won twice. I don't ever have to campaign again.
So they can say whatever the fuck they want.
Which to me sounded like, fuck is all. The gloves are off now.
Mm-hmm.
I've been waiting 6 years for this.
So what do you think were his best points?
How about more family leave?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I heard about that one. Like, I've read a little bit about it.
Mm-hmm. That's all I've heard. I keep meaning to go back to it and find it and listen to it. It's so hard coming home from work. I almost always think that.
Mm-hmm.
That's getting old. Then I just heard, the only real thing I heard about after that was the trying to extend the family medical leave, and getting Americans up to a living wage.
Mm-hmm.
So, all right, man.
Sounds good.
Do it.
We talked a little bit last week about the 2 years of free community college. Have you learned
any
more about that? Do you want to speak on that some more?
I have not heard any more about that.
Oh, that's a bummer. I really expect there'd be lots of just squabbling and back and forth about that.
I think he derailed them with family leave. You know? Oh no, we can't do that.
Distractions.
Although at the same time he's kind of thrown so much shit at them all at once.
Mm-hmm.
They could just be scrambling to come up with what the hell to think anymore. You know?
As usual.
I feel like they're
always kind of trying to pull something out of your ass.
Yeah, so there's my boy. Suddenly he's turned into Clint Eastwood. I'm telling you. He's just kind of dead-eyeing them now and being like, coming up with things like, how can I piss them off now?
Mm-hmm. They really can't do anything to him anymore. They can't hurt his campaign. Like, you know, he pretty much said, like, I'm done campaigning.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just going to veto whatever I want.
And I would bet you anything, he does like a talk show circuit for the rest of his life.
You should interview him.
You know, when he starts running low on money, he'll go do a college circuit, you know,
mm-hmm.
and speak at all the colleges and stuff like that. And people would go in droves, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm, definitely.
I'm just like, come on, man, tell me about Roswell.
I don't think the president, if there's something to know, I don't think the president knows.
I would think that if any president knew and was going to tell about it, it'd be him right now. He'd be standing up in front of the podium in front of the whole crowd and be like,
guess what, guys?
I'm going to tell them. I'm going to tell them. What are you going to do? What are you going to do? I'm going to tell them.
I think, you know, if there was something to know, and it's been this whole conspiracy, like, ever since. I think, you know, whatever's going on is, like, so serious that if the ominous day, if they knew he was going to leak, like, they would assassinate him. He'd be dead.
Mm-hmm.
I really don't buy the whole, like, they're not ready to know there'll be, like, global revolution. Like, I don't buy that at all.
I personally love conspiracy theory. I absolutely love it, and if a documentary pops up on it, I'll put it on and I'll watch it. And
mm-hmm.
it's really only fun when Jeannie's here, you know.
When who's here?
Kind of Jeannie.
Oh, Jeannie.
Yeah. Your aunt Jean? I'm not sure.
Yeah, I know. I thought you said Jimmy. I was like, I don't know who that is.
There are so many of you people. who's related to who. But just to sit here and watch conspiracy theory and, you know, playing on Facebook, doing other stuff, and just I love listening for the giant leaps in logic, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Just kind of like, okay, how the hell did you get there?
I know, like sometimes that happens. Like some of them are pretty solid. You know, some of them have, you know, proven true after time. But then there's, you know, some of them just kind of invalidate all the other ones and undermine everybody who says, you know what, the official story is not true.
Mm-hmm.
The batshit crazy people just ruin it for everybody.
Exactly, yeah. You know, the conspiracy buffs are the best people for covering shit up ever.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Because you're trying to get at some kind of truth, and then they come popping up with their whack-ball theories and crap,
uh-huh.
And then you can't hear anything else.
Yeah, and they're turning conspiracy theorists into a bad word.
It's a bad word?
Yeah, it's an insult now. Like, oh, you're
well,
conspiracy theorist.
Me, personally, I've seen too many stupid ones to not think that way.
Exactly.
You know, it's not like other people have told me that. I've watched them. I've listened to them a lot. You
mm-hmm.
know? Of course, the two top heavy hitters, David Icke, or
mm-hmm.
David Icke over in England, in the UK. Oh, he is so much fun. Blonde babies are more delicious. That's basically what it comes
I saw
to.
Him
That's,
say that.
You saw him say that? Awesome.
Yeah, didn't he say that?
Basically, yeah. So that's why satanic cults prefer the blood of blonde children more than other children.
I would just expect those ethnocentrism and racism, but
it's tastier to the reptilian aliens from the fifth dimension
mm-hmm.
who are impersonating the heads of England and the United States.
Right. Yeah, I've watched like all his stuff too. It's pretty funny.
He's fun. Alex Jones is always good for a couple of kicks.
I don't like Alex Jones at all.
Yeah.
He's always wrong, like pretty much, and he's loud and obnoxious. He's a big asshole.
I'm not sure with either one of these people if like is exactly the right word. You know, I like David Icke. I don't think it's the same kind of thing as what me and Bami got.
What's that?
Obama.
Oh.
I call him
Bami. I know what you're saying. This is starting to get weird.
And we hold hands and we skip.
Uh huh.
And pick me flowers.
Uh huh. After your nap, though.
But he is definitely leading us to the road to utopia.
I think all the good things he's done, there's just as many things that have set us back.
There are certain things that have set us back. Again, go back and listen to last week's episode. Yeah, the whole NSA
the indefinite
thing,
detention.
Expanding
detention. NSA.
Yeah. And the one I forgot to mention is Gitmo's still open. That was one of your promises. You going to get to this one?
Mm-hmm.
You know? You're doing all this other stuff. What's up? You know, so.
I kind of feel like indefinite detention, it prompts everything he's done. Like, it goes beyond freedom of speech, like freedom of self.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's a major strike against him on that
mm-hmm.
one.
We might as well be in France where we can't, you know, quote unquote glorify crimes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And
I feel like at least in
Now, that didn't start with him, but he could have ended it, you know, and he didn't. Mm-hmm. And I don't see any reason why he didn't.
Yeah, I think the drone program, drone surveillance, and drone bombing did start with him.
Yes, this is true. Uh-huh. The drone attacks, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I've been iffy on him for the whole 6 years. You know?
I think by now, like, he might just be trying to make a good legacy for himself. And that's a possibility.
Possibly. For the last 6 years, I've kind of just had the attitude of, well, he's better than what we had. Which kind of views basically my politics across the board. It's like, you know, it's not like we're going to get a good politician,
mm-hmm.
you know. We just kind of have to hope that we get one that's better than the last one.
Right.
So, yeah, there are a lot of bad marks against him as well there. But I love his style with what he's doing now. I mean, it's what he's doing, and it's the way he's doing it.
Mm-hmm.
It really just smells like, fuck you people.
Yeah, but hopefully when everybody remembers the last 2 years, they remember his other actions. And he still has time to undo what he's done that's really bad. He has time to undo. He has time to close Gitmo. He has time to kind of pull back his drone campaigns. He has time to kind of shutter NSA a little bit, chill them out. He has time to do that, but his time will be running out shortly.
Yeah. Let's see what happens.
I can always hope for good things. You know, I hope he does what he should do. I hope he does the right thing. But at the same time, he is a politician.
Yeah.
And it's not always, you know, just up to them. There's a bunch of other asshole politicians pulling strings and, you know, putting up roadblocks and all kinds of things. You know, it's the whole system that's bad. It's all the corruption throughout the whole thing. As the, you know, the president, we should see him working towards doing what I've just mentioned.
Yeah. So what do you think of 4 years of Hillary?
No, I don't think I like her too much. I don't think she's going to be much better than Obama. She's kind of a warmonger herself.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the only good point I know of for her would be standing up for reproductive rights. Because that gets really attacked, you know, constantly. You know, I don't think it's anybody's business if I want to go get some birth control pills. It's nobody's business. 25 years old. Nobody's business. You know, if I end up needing to get an abortion, it's nobody's right or business to tell me not to.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And like all prohibitions, doesn't really
it just makes
you.
It worse.
Mm-hmm. Right. So we just add another criminal activity to the list of criminal activities. More women will die getting illegal abortions. More
mm-hmm.
criminals will make
can't
a lot
access
of money
birth
getting
control.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it'll just go back to how it was.
Mm-hmm. It's going to totally spiral out of control.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever seen the documentary Freakonomics?
I have, yeah.
You have? Do you,
mm-hmm.
do you remember the bit in there where he could show statistically that crime rates have lowered
mm-hmm.
since abortion?
Yeah, I have gotten in so much trouble on the internet for, like, showing that graph. And not even, like, from conservatives or anything, just, like, people who think they're really smart, independent, like,
yeah.
politically. And so they started calling me a liberal, and I was like, no, not really. I'm just looking at facts. They can't force people to have kids. And they want to talk about how women are sluts, you know, for having sex, being on birth control. I'm like, are you fucking kidding me? Like, you don't want to have sex? Is that what you're telling me?
Mm-hmm.
Are you not a slut? How about you get a uterus? Try it out.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the only good point about Hillary I can think of.
Yeah.
You know, if she does come up for starts campaigning everything and comes up, I'll have to research for more, definitely.
Yeah. But she's definitely, you know, at this point, I can't see how she's not going to just walk in, you know. The GOP is so messed up that they can't come up with a fucking candidate that can speak in full sentences anymore.
When was the last time they even did that ever?
So the closest they're going to come up with, there's serious talk about them running Jeb Bush.
I know, that's so crazy. Like, can we have a Republican not from that same family? Like, it's not a, what's it called? It's not a matriarchy, no. It's a royal line. Not what we have here. And, like, I feel like that is the group of people politically that would be most against it.
Mm-hmm. Not another 8 years of Bush.
Seriously.
Really?
Bush, the last one was like handicapped or something. I don't know. Like, I was in like high school and I was like, what's wrong with this guy?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so many of the stupid fuck ups, you know, people write your speeches for you.
I know. And everybody knows that. But like, they, I don't know. They still fuck it up and somehow, like, they're not chased out of their tent or whatever.
Uh-huh.
People still support them. I don't get it. It's that tribal mentality I'm talking about in politics. And my side versus your side.
Uh-huh.
Red versus blue. Uh-huh. Like, it's so, like, straightforward and obvious.
And a third-party candidate just doesn't stand a chance, which...
Not ever. Like, this whole system kind of screws them over. Like, actually, when they're speaking, like, the crowd likes what they're saying, but when they air on TV, they edit them out for the most part. They kind of don't show them. They kind of don't, like, ask them a lot of questions. They purposely make it between candidate A and B, Democrat and Republican. Like,
uh-huh.
It just only keeps this binding. It's simple. It keeps people, like, kind of organized against each other. It's just convenient.
And how surprising would it be if they just kind of had it worked out with each other?
Had it worked out with each other?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Well, picture my boy Obama, before going out for the State of the Union, going back to wherever the GOP hang out and just being like, okay, you know what I'm going to cover? Okay, good. You got it all down? Okay. Have you worked on your outrage yet? Okay. like both sides are just staged.
Well, it probably is, especially in campaigns. It definitely, especially for debates and stuff, I can't imagine that it's not. They don't kind of have a little get together and talk about stuff. Especially, they probably talk about the talking points with the hosts, too, on these shows. And people asking the questions and everything.
Mm-hmm.
It's not much better than North Korea.
No. Yeah, you got a point. You definitely got a point.
I mean, nobody wants their candidate and somebody on their show, like, getting shocked at the question, feeling like, dumbfounded, like, not knowing how to answer it. And that might happen sometimes. But, you know, they have, like, teleprompters. Probably even in the debates. What do you think? Do you think they have teleprompters in the debates?
I'm not sure. Maybe just to read the questions. Because they come off kind of stupid in the debates. Well, at least the last round of debates was Romney, you know?
Well, I mean.
Huh?
Well, I mean. It is Romney.
Yeah. I mean, you know, well, right there, even if there was a teleprompter, he might not have been able to read it. You know, he certainly wouldn't have said as much of the flat-out stupid shit that he said.
What did he say? Because I didn't watch that either. I was much more interested in kind of understanding the system than individual people.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, one of the things that he said is that he doesn't care about jobs. It's not important to him.
What's important? What takes, you know, the place of that in his,
yeah,
you know, 4-year plan?
Yeah. When at the time it was like the biggest thing on all of America's mind, you know, the bad economy and people not working and all that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, nice you don't care, too.
You just don't care about anything.
Something I think that we might have talked on the now famous Destination Utopia episode, which we might want to bring up again, the Sarah Palin dog stepping pictures.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, we had a good talk about that. Yeah, so she stepped on, you know, the kids stepped on the dog and everybody politicized it immediately. And just because they're liberal and hate conservatives, like, there's a big fucking deal. I mean, realistically, the kids shouldn't have been doing that, and she shouldn't have, like, glorified it, put it on the internet, and talked about the dog being a stepping stone or whatever. She should have told the kid to get off. You can't stand on it because you're just going to get bigger. You know, and maybe she did, you know, after she took the picture and everything. Who knows? Nobody knows. You know, if it wasn't animal abuse, the dog wasn't in pain, he didn't jump up and leave. None of that happened. He looked at the kid, he laid back down. Like, you can't train an animal to just calmly submit to pain.
Yeah. Let me kind of cut through it a little. Sarah Palin is a fucking idiot. Okay?
Oh, she is.
She's a fucking idiot. But with this one, people are just reaching too far.
Mm-hmm. They just want something to bitch about, and they just hate her for reasons, and they're going to hate on this because they hate her.
He shouldn't have been stepping on the dog, but it's not the end of the world.
Mm-hmm. My kids do that, and you tell them not to, and you know what happens? You know, it happens all the time, so that happens all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's not
the whole thing is ridiculous.
It's not like he was stepping on a chihuahua either.
I know.
It was a decent-sized dog. It didn't look like it was minding too terribly much. You know? Not that he should step on the dog anyway.
Mm-hmm. Hopefully he doesn't do it again.
Yeah. Dogs are forgiving like that. You know?
Mm-hmm. You know, when they're playing, like, they body slam and jump on each other and bite each other and, like, hit each other in the face.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it reminds me of when Michael Jackson dangled baby out of the window,
mm-hmm.
and everybody made such a huge deal out of it. Okay, maybe not exactly the best thing in the world, but that's what people do with babies.
They hang them out in a third-story window. I don't think I would ever do that.
Yeah. You know, I spent my earlier years in New York City. I lived to the age of 5 in the Bronx. 5 or 8, I forget. It's a long time ago. and at that time, my family was, my extended family was fairly large. They're mostly dead now. It was, my father was like the youngest of that lot, you know.
Uh-huh.
So we went to a lot of funerals growing up. But at that time, everybody was in the Bronx and surrounding areas. And
mm-hmm.
pretty much every weekend, somebody had a party. You know. And
that sounds
fun. That's what, you know, you would have your weddings, you would have your christenings, you would have your confirmations, you'd have your 3-16s. You know, these were all family events. And then, if nothing else was going on, you had a party for the fuck of it. You know? many a baby, including me, were hung out windows, saying goodbye to the relatives as they were leaving.
Mm-hmm.
not the best thing to do in the world. Could have dropped the baby. I've never heard of a baby being dropped, but I'm sure babies have been dropped. But it reminds me a lot of the Sarah Palin dog thing. It's kind of, you're making a big deal out of nothing.
Yeah.
You know?
And it'd be a lot more constructive to, instead of, jumping on it like that and just viciously hating on the person, you should actually have a dialogue about it. Like, maybe that's not the best thing.
Yeah. I'm not really one to be sticking up for Michael Jackson, but then I'm really not one for sticking up for Sarah Palin either. You know? But it's just how extremist we have gotten in this country.
Yeah, it kind of locks us in. If we identify with a certain party or ideology, then we have to go along with it. And everything gets politicized. You have to take sides on everything. You have to take your correct side. And so many people are so swept up in that. Real issues are never even really dealt with. We argue about stupid shit, and even real issues that we talk about, just missing the point entirely because they're so bent on being completely opposed to each other.
Yeah.
Because we can't agree because we're different. We have to pretend that we're different.
What do you think so I can think the other way?
Exactly, yeah. I see you doing something, now I think I'll never do that because obviously it's wrong.
Mm-hmm.
It's just ridiculous, and it's kind of a form of social control.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's a lot of social control, just the way businesses and jobs are is 8 hours of social control out of your life every day.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there, everybody's trying to tell you what it is you should like or what you should not like,
That's it's inherent when you're living in a society. The grand scale of it now is just crazy.
Yeah. Yeah. And again, extremes, back in the 70s was when child abuse started becoming a big topic and a big issue. And that's where things started getting a little bit more control and child protective services and things along that line.
Now, obviously, it's good to kind of work against children being abused.
Yeah, but when it comes down to you can't give your kid a rap in a store because he's being a little bitch, that's where the baby goes out with the bathwater.
Yeah, definitely. I saw something on the internet the other day. Some parents were taken into custody. They were arrested for letting their children walk home alone. From the park or from school or something. I'm not sure where this place was. I don't think it was a not exactly dangerous place any more than any other normal place. So it's just kind of, you have to let kids grow up at a certain age, they can walk home alone. And you can't control people's families so much. If the parents are working, they're going to go to jail because they're not holding their child's hand every day, every step of the way. If they don't work, then they can't provide for their child, and they're going to go to jail for, neglect or something. It's kind of putting people in a really hard position, just getting more and more and more laws, kind of like we talked about before, earlier today.
To protect us from, in
from
my opinion, is more hype than reality. Yes,
there's more
are
what? I didn't quite.
It
got kind of fuzzy. I can't hear you.
Okay. Something that is more hype than reality, that everybody's out to get your kids, and there are pedophiles jumping out of bushes everywhere.
Right.
It's not, I don't want to come out pro-pedophilia here,
I hope not.
but they're an oddity.
Mm-hmm.
They're a rarity. There aren't that many out there. Okay? Not that
mm-hmm.
any of them out there are a good thing. You know?
Right.
But it's nothing to be that afraid of. You know, you can get hit by lightning. You know?
I think
but we don't go cowering under the beds over lightning.
Well, I mean, some people do.
Yeah, some people do.
But yeah, I mean, there's so many things that could happen that you're going to be so caught up in making sure every child has somebody's hand to hold on the way from school and everything. You're going to miss so many other things. So you're just going to start ignoring, you know, all the other things could happen, you know, lightning, if it was, like, actually a big deal.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, when you get hit by lightning, it's a serious thing, and it's really bad. And if something happens to your child, that is a million times worse. But
mm-hmm.
it seems more about keeping us in a state of fear, and by
oh,
that,
definitely.
Keeping us under control. You know,
mm-hmm.
so therefore, you know, stay in your houses. Don't let your kids play outside. You know, I mean, people talk about video games and things like that. Oh, the kids never go outside, blah, blah, and isn't it a shame? But what would really happen if the kids did go outside?
I know, they'd ride their bikes and get some exercise and make friends in person. I think, you know, the benefits definitely outweigh the possible danger.
But they're out there alone. Something's going to happen. They're going to get hurt, or if they're not going to get hurt, they're going to hurt other people because they're kids and they're rotten. You know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
That's what kids do. Like all of that, like getting hit with rocks and throwing dirt clods around. Like that's how they learn.
Those were the days, man. I'm telling you.
I was probably the last person able to do that.
When I was a kid. And I love bringing this up because this is, when I was a kid, there was a popular toy, okay? And it came in a wide variety of different things that you can do with the same kind of theory. Creepy crawlies. You ever heard of creepy crawlies?
Not that toy, no.
Okay. Creepy crawlies was a toy for kids. Ages 8 and above, I think. And what it was two steel plates that would have big engravings or molds of, like, spiders and centipedes and stuff like that. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And you would fill the tray with this stuff called goop. Okay? Which was basically a soft liquid plastic.
Mm-hmm.
And you would
some,
put that
some,
in the tray.
Some kid eat it, and then they ban this way.
Oh, fuck that. You would close the tray, and then you would plug this into the electric. And
wow.
And the plates would get hot, like a hot plate.
Uh-huh.
Like you could cook a sandwich on these things. Because it's literally cooking plastic.
Uh-huh. That is a crazy kid's toy.
And you would then turn it off, allow it to cool down, and you would open it up, and you would have these little plasticky, rubbery spiders and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the days, man. We learned some stuff back then.
Yeah, that's like...
You don't
kind
try to play.
Have better life skills than even the toys I had.
Yeah.
Don't touch the hot plate. This is what happens when you cook plastic, blah, blah, blah. That sounds really fun. It's much better than Easy Bake Oven. And kind of the same kind of line of thought, though.
Yeah. Oh, those Easy Bake Ovens got really hot, too, yeah.
I just
didn't play with very many of them. Huh?
Yeah, I didn't either. But I know that you just had, like, some mix. You put it in a bowl with some water, and then you put it in. I guess my mom never, like, saw the point, because, like, we had a real oven.
It would cook a real little cake, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Did yours have the light bulb, or did they up the technology from that?
I don't know. I never had one.
Oh, you never had one?
Yeah, I'm surprised.
The ones that I remembered basically cooked with an incandescent light bulb.
Oh, wow.
You know, so basically a regular household light bulb.
Uh-huh.
Which
cut off the
really,
reflecting
really hot,
surfaces inside to
yeah.
can direct
uh-huh.
the heat on the cake. Wow.
Mm-hmm.
That's not nearly as bad as, like, an open hot plate, hot metal
oh,
sitting there cooking
genius.
Plastic.
The world is so safe now.
We're, like, more scared than ever.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's an interesting point, isn't it, if you think about it? We're a lot safer
now. Statistically, your kid is a lot more likely to get snatched up by somebody you know. So you're going to tell this person, your neighbor, to go hold your kid's hand on the way home from school, and they're going to be the ones, like, snatching him up. There's a hilarious South Park episode, like, about exactly that. Like, my parents read or were told that the person most likely to kidnap their kid was, you know, themselves, the parents. And so they sent their kids off so they wouldn't get kidnapped. South Park
they
is
sent
great.
The kid off so it wouldn't get kidnapped.
Yeah, because most likely it'd be the parent kidnapping them. So they sent them off somewhere, I don't remember where, so they wouldn't get kidnapped.
Save them from us.
Mm-hmm. So there's actually another point I wanted to get back to, going back to Charlie Hebdo and kind of that whole kind of situation of free speech.
Yeah.
And so what do you think, you know, in a utopian society, you know, where would the balance be? What's the relationship between the free speech and personal responsibility? Like, should there be kind of a middle ground where free speech and personal responsibility kind of overlap, or don't overlap, or what am I trying to say? Should it be total free speech and you're supposed to be responsible for yourself, or should the government step in and tell you what you can and cannot say? In a utopian society, the ideal, what would you like to see?
That's a tough one because there's free speech in general is a really tough one. Because there have been times where free speech also rubs up against personal liberty as well.
But I think as long as it doesn't infringe upon liberty, I think that's definitely the end of free speech.
What's the end of free speech?
When it starts infringing on people's liberty. Because then it's not really free speech anymore. You're also kind of breaking the law of personal liberty.
Yeah. You definitely shouldn't shoot people.
Well, that's not free speech. That's definitely murder.
Yeah. You know, but at the same time, it's like, should the Duck Dynasty guy lose his job?
I feel like it was kind of like a public push for that to happen. So that was free speech coming from the opposite side. They're kind of using
right.
their horses and their dollars on the network.
Right. He was not impeded from saying what he said or anything like that.
If you have a speech, you don't have freedom from kind of social consequences. And that doesn't include, like, getting shot up and stuff like that.
How much of that was really social, you know, social conscience? Blah. You know, it was more a company that doesn't want to lose its money.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? I mean,
yeah.
The only
reason they would have lost their money is for the social push.
If people were outraged and then rushed to watch the show, he wouldn't have lost the show.
You know?
Whether people were outraged or not. You know, the outrage doesn't really seem to play into it.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you said something, we're going to lose money. That's it. And I think that there should be some kind of protections for that.
So you think that the network, let's say, would be required to hold his contract?
Well, I think jobs in general should not be able to penalize you for what for the things that you do outside of that job.
That's true.
You know, I totally forget where he said it, how he said it, or anything else. You know,
I think, you know, some of the things he said were on the show, and some of the things he said were in interviews.
Yeah.
So in the interview, like, that's kind of entangled up with the show, though. So that's kind of a blurry line.
Yeah. Another one that happened fairly recently, Rob Schneider.
You
know
what did he
right?
do? Yeah, I know him.
Okay. Well, he, State Farm was having a series of commercials for, you know, kind of old, offbeat characters, things like that. And they decided they were going to use him, the making copies guy from Saturday Night Live that he used to do, which was annoying as hell. You know, and I think they did Hands and Friends and things like that. You know, those sorts of things, really kind of retro things for their State Farm commercials. And then it was found out that Rob Schneider has anti-immunization beliefs.
Uh-huh.
I don't believe he even actually, I think it's things that he had said prior. Like it's not like he came out somewhere and started spouting shit and he got fired. He got fired for having the beliefs.
Mm-hmm. That's definitely unconstitutional.
They didn't feel it was in line with State Farm, an insurance company.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
I think there's kind of a different situation when you're a celebrity like that and you're like a public icon. It kind of, your image is your job, basically.
Yeah. And in both cases, we are speaking about idiots. Okay. But you should have the right to be an idiot.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And, okay, they're public figures, but I'm sure you can see how that can extend. You know?
Yeah, I can see how it can extend. I'm just not sure, you know, where that line is, you know?
Yeah. I have heard of people getting fired for things that they've done outside work. Well, most jobs, and it's still here in Colorado, it hasn't changed in Colorado yet, that if you get injured on your job, then you will be immediately drug tested.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if you come up positive, you're fired.
Mm-hmm. It makes sense. It kind of, like, I understand not wanting to have tweakers on a job site, definitely.
Okay, but this is still something that you are doing outside in your own personal
mm-hmm.
life.
But you can even drink, get drunk before work and come in drunk, even though the action that caused it was not on the clock.
Yeah. But then they can use that against you to not be liable for your injury.
That's true also. But at the same time, they're not liable if you are actually drunk.
Right, but you were drunk at that time. If you are drunk, you are still doing something on the job. You are drunk.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you were drunk the night before,
well, that doesn't count.
Right.
And that's kind of what we're trying to get to is they can't penalize you for something you did the night before that's not affecting today at all.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll still say that it does, and it'll still be in your system. Unfortunately, weed stays in for a really long time, which is really stupid because it's the most benign thing ever.
Yeah.
They definitely see where it's coming from. And there's kind of, you know, there's a difficult way to kind of align things because on one hand, you can't be working drunk and usually you shouldn't be working stoned. definitely shouldn't be tweaking on the job. You know, on the other hand, you should have the right to do that off the job. Then you have people messed up for everybody, and we'll go get drunk at work and be stoned at work, and it causes this whole problem.
Mm-hmm. I think that at this point, we should let free speech get as free as it could possibly get. Let's try that for a little while.
Mm-hmm.
And then start deciding where to pull back on it.
And later decide to pull back on it, or kind of have that in the plan the whole time?
I'm sorry?
Would you repeat what you said?
I think free speech, we should try letting free speech get as free as it could possibly get.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then from there, take a look and see where, okay, maybe that's a little too free. Maybe we need to back down
mm-hmm.
on that a bit.
Well, I feel like we already tried that. That's kind of, we're kind of in the pulling back stage right now.
How so?
I think speech was a lot more free previously. And now we have things, especially in France. So we have that going on in France. We used to have, way free speech. Not having different laws, can't deny the Holocaust, you can't be apologist, can't glorify crime. I'm trying to think of specifically in U.S. Legislation that's against free speech. But they're trying to make a free speech zones where you can only have free speech within the zone, or trying to pull back hoods, make it illegal to wear hoodies and certain clothing.
Yeah.
So they're pulling back on things right now.
I don't know. Well, I see your point. I see your point. But I don't think that free speech has gotten free enough yet.
Mm-hmm. So at what point in our history do you think was the most free? I haven't studied history enough to really have an adequate answer for that.
What point in history was the freest for speech?
Mm-hmm. For the United States, it was kind of like a tenant of our country.
Well, for the United States, I would have to go to the Revolution, I would think.
Mm-hmm. So you think it's kind of gradually gotten a bit less free since then?
I'm sorry, you kind of cracked up on me a little bit.
So you think since that period of time, it's kind of gotten progressively less free? It's kind of like a gradual roll. So during the Revolution, you're saying whatever we want, pretty much, legally speaking, wear what we want and all that. And now we have people making certain clothing illegal, trying to, certain celebrities talking about making certain words illegal. So it becomes from, complete freedom to complete ridiculousness.
I think you get to a point where, bang, there's a revolution, and that's the freest you are, free in movement, free in speech, free in everything, and freedom is the major thing on everybody's mind, and as soon as that stuff settles, then it automatically starts constricting again.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's true. That's a good point. There's kind of, chaos is not the freedom. I think, the focus was a lot on freedom through speech, and people a lot more focused on security now and being safe.
Yeah. Our founding fathers were awesome, and they would so cry if they saw this country now.
Mm-hmm.
They were radicals and they were rebels. I don't know why conservatives forget that.
Because they're not. They're not what they say they are.
They kind of want to look at the founding fathers like they were in church all the time.
Mm-hmm. And go on and on how America needs to go back to being a Christian country. It was never the case.
Yeah, and it was never a Christian country. Our founding fathers, for the most part, were not Christians.
Mm-hmm.
And some were atheists.
Mm-hmm.
Have you heard of the Jefferson Bible?
I have not.
You have not. Oh, look this up. Look this up for some of what our founding fathers were. Thomas Jefferson, Declaration of Independence, all that. He's kind of famous.
I haven't heard his Bible.
Decided he was going to go through the Bible and keep just the bits that he felt were important.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Wasn't that kind of what they all do?
What?
Isn't that what all Christians do?
Well, what he came out with was basically a pamphlet.
Mm-hmm. That was funny.
So, like,
so
he went
able to read the whole thing.
Yeah. He came out with this very, very small book.
That's awesome.
And it's called the Jefferson Bible.
I'll have to look that up. Definitely. We can talk about that next week.
Yes. Jeannie should be home soon, so I should wrap it up.
All right. Well, I think this was a great episode. I'm going to start sharing it now, have people start listening now that I'm a lot more comfortable. And, you know, have some topics, you know, talk about, have my bullet points and everything.
Yeah. Remember, the episodes come out on Tuesday. Okay?
Okay.
And I do like the idea of the bullet points. I think that's a good way to go, because that's also going to help me kind of advertise the upcoming episode.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it helps me, like, organize my thoughts and everything.
Yeah. I could do a banner like I do for the Pope on film, and instead of the film that we're doing, I could put the Muhammad crying picture on it, because it's so popular. You know?
Right, there
and
you go.
That's basically what we're covering. So until next week, I am Bunny Williams, and with me is...
Rose Mead.
And we'll see you in paradise.
Utopia.